Morrison is the Chief Wellness Officer at the Cleveland Clinic and served as the first chair of the Wellness Institute. His impact in leading the Institute has been significant, helping participating employees to lose more than 1.5 pounds per year, reduce smoking from 15% to 5%, and decrease healthcare costs for 4 consecutive years. Dr. Royson has founded 12 companies, co-invented an FDA-approved drug, and published 4 number one New York Times bestsellers among 9 New York Times bestsellers that he has published. He has also published 175 peer-reviewed journal articles, given over 1,400 talks to both lay and medical professionals, and writes a daily column with Dr. Oz that is syndicated in 134 newspapers. We are very excited and pleased to have him here with us tonight to kick off the Batante Medical Symposium. And I was really impressed, too, with his sports knowledge. It was really fun to talk with him prior to coming over. So please welcome with me Dr. Michael Royson.
I'm really privileged to be here. President Pressel, thank you. Gary and David, thank you. And you especially, thank you. This talk started really because of Toby Cosgrove, the CEO of the Cleveland Clinic's passion for saying Cleveland Clinic couldn't continue to lead in healthcare unless we stopped the influx of chronic disease. So I've divided this talk into 3 parts. One is what the Cleveland Clinic has done and what it's resulted in and what it could result in for the country. Secondly, 10 things each of you can do. That's the middle real part of the lecture. And then to tell you the scary or opportunistic future of what is likely to happen within 10 or 15 years. I'm a academic, so I disclose my conflicts. I did write these books. So if you buy them, I enjoy a royalty, so thank you. And those 2 companies still exist. And aging, which is really what we're talking about, is a worldwide concern. Veja is the national magazine of Brazil, and I've been on the cover 5 times. If you're a guy, you can't find me because I'm way up there. You didn't see me, did you? And the latest book is called Age Proof. And the real reason behind Age Proof is because health and finances are going to be more and more closely intertwined in our long-term planning. And with that education, and you'll see why I believe every educational institution will be transformed and even more important going forward. The same strategies, that is doing things automatically for your health, doing things automatically to put money away, planning for the future, are the same type of strategies in the 2. But the real revolution that's coming is that each of us will be able to be roughly half the age we are. So you're 74, if I can give away your age, just imagine functioning as though you were 37. That's what's coming, and it's coming much faster than we think. And that's what the last part of it is, because that changes everything. Many people look at it as, if you will, a scary part. How am I going to afford that? But basically, it's going to be, how are we going to educate all of us to be retrained repeatedly so that we can, in fact, take that opportunity and enjoy it. The fact you're here in an educational institution means you're probably going to be in short supply, meaning there isn't going to be a shortage of jobs for you, there will be a shortage of you. And there'll be plenty of jobs. The outline, so why healthcare needs to be fixed. We can't do, if you look at what they've been talking about in Washington, it's been how do we fix the financing of healthcare, not how do we fix healthcare. So we're going to talk about how we have to fix healthcare if major social disruption is to be avoided. That's probably, for those of us in healthcare, the scariest part. The second is 9 or 10 steps, depending on what you want to do, that can keep you and your brain healthy and younger, so you will be able to enjoy it. And the third is the next disruptor. Really, the last disruptor was the chip, and it's changed things for the last 60 years since it's been here in radical ways. That if you remember, IBM said we only need 3 computers for all of America. Most of you probably have 3 computers that you deal with every day. That chip has made things very, very different. Well, this disruptor is too. Imagine yourself living much, much younger for much, much longer, and our thought processes of education, job, retirement are probably going to have to change, where it'll be education, job, education, job, education, job, education, job, sabbatical, education, job, etc. And when we go on retirement isn't clear. The reason I got into this is partly what Gary and David do. That is, when I was at UC San Francisco in 1978, I was asked to chair anesthesia. I was asked to chair the cardiovascular anesthesia group because no one wanted to work with those surgeons. And when we started, because all they cared about was the outcome of patients, and which is what you want. But they were nasty to everybody else to get that outcome. And when you looked at the what determined outcome, it was age. So a 75-year-old, and this is still true today, a 75-year-old, everything else being equal, same blood pressure, same cholesterol levels, et cetera, has 3 times the risk of complications and of death as a 65-year-old undergoing the exact same operation, 9 times of a 55-year-old. So I said, geez, our job in anesthesia was to see if we could make patients 10 years younger in the perioperative period. It's doable. It was very easy to do it. But in learning how to do that and motivate people to get younger, we learned a lot about aging. Now, just to give you, well, I'll come back to that. But aging is also the leading risk factor for heart disease and stroke. Young people generally get this much less common. It's the leading risk factor for arthritis. You don't see 20-year-olds getting arthritis. It's the leading risk factor for cataracts and macular degeneration. It's the leading risk factor for type 2 diabetes, for cancer, for frailty, for mental dysfunction. So, what the revolution is for the first time 3 months ago, June 16th, the FDA said we will study a drug, allow a drug to be studied with aging as the endpoint. The FDA has always been a disease-oriented thing, just like NIH. Heart disease, so there's an advisory committee for heart disease. There's an advisory committee for women's cancer. There's an advisory committee for neurologic disease. There's an advisory committee for digestive disease. There actually are 16 of them. But there's never been one for the overall factor of aging until, in fact, June 16th, when everything changed. That means if you stop aging, you radically change all of those things. Give you the idea. From the worst cholesterol, 260 LDL, to the best, under 70, is a 3-fold decrease in risk. From the worst blood pressure that I can imagine to the ideal, a 5-fold increase in risk. From chronologic age of 65 and a real age of 75 to what you could get at 65, 35, is a 27-fold decrease. So aging is a much greater thing to affect your life than anything else. And the wonderful thing is you're going to be half, or be able to be half as old as you are now. How old are you? 73. Were you the same class as she was? Anyway, so just imagine being 37 again. And that's, and within 15 years, we think that's what's going to happen. So I'm going to get to that to part three, but let me do the key thing. So this is the CBO's estimate of the next 70 years of healthcare costs. And as a percent of GDP, this is a federal budget. You'll notice everything in the federal budget, that includes defense, Social Security, everything else, goes down over the next 70 years as a percent of GDP, assuming a 2.5% growth rate of GDP. This little blip here is the baby boomer Social Security blip. Hardly shows, right? Everybody talks about it. But this is what healthcare costs are doing. In fact, in the CBO's estimate, in 2055, we would have to have a marginal tax rate of 75%, and every other bracket would have to go up by 75%. So if you're in a 15% bracket, you'd have to be in about a 27% bracket. If you're in a 20% bracket, you'd have to be in a 35% bracket. So you'd have to pay the federal government a lot more to keep the deficit the same as it is now. But this is a gross underestimate. The reason Toby Cosgrove and the reason I'm so passionate about this is because we only have 2024. Because the CBO only took three things into account. The aging of the population, that was 62% of that slope. So the reason the slope isn't zero, 62% of it is as we get older. Remember, aging is the leading factor for diseases. 17% is new technology, 21% was the increased cost from Obamacare's increased access. So you see, only these three things. But in fact, we have an influx of chronic disease. And this is the real curve. We only have till 2024 before society gets disrupted if we go the same way we're going now. And that's because of the influx, as I said, of chronic disease. And you know that. When I started practicing, 2.2 million diabetics out of the 211 million people in the United States, we only had an hour on type 2 diabetes in medical school. Recently, 29 million. It's growing sevenfold faster than the population. And the prediction is it keeps growing. You'll notice 120 to 220 million. Again, sixfold faster than the population by 2050. And it's hitting those marks. Hip and knee arthroplasty, when I started, 67,000 were done. Recently, 1 million. And the prediction is, again, growing sixfold faster than the population over the next 30 years. Dementia care, $216 billion in 2015, the federal government. Again, going fivefold faster than the population by 2050. And so that's the real problem. And by the way, it isn't just the United States problem. The reason we're the leading edge is because you're being treated for this. Let me relate that again. In the United States, we had 29 million diabetics, type 2 diabetics. 16.9 million were being treated for. The rest we didn't know or didn't know. But we were treating the majority of the diabetics, and they used 1.5% of GDP. Not 1.5% of medical costs. It was a little over 15% of medical costs. 1.5% of GDP. In China, they have, in fact, if you look at it, I'll get to it, 607 million people with type 2 diabetes. Many more than the United States has. But you'd say, what's the difference? Well, we're treating 16.9 million. China is only treating, if you will, 11.6 million. They have 20 times as many people with type 2 diabetes as we do. They just aren't being treated yet. But they will get there. The good news about this from America is we're exporting our bad habits pretty quickly. The bad news is the entire world has the same problem that will result in social disruption. When you look at things, and I wanted to, because this is really a problem now, I want to talk a little bit about addiction, and tobacco is one of the addictions. But if you will, 17% of us are genetically addictable. What do I mean by that? I mean one puff of a cigarette, if you're addicted to cigarettes, you're addicted. It's not that you have to have a lot of puffs. You get one puff and you're addicted. It is one shot of fentanyl and you're addicted. It is one drink and you're addicted. There are, if you will, in America, our genes are such that 17% of us are really easy to addict. And it isn't the high that's bad. It's the side effects that are bad. So with the fentanyl, or I can talk about with the tobacco, the nicotine isn't the problem. It's the hydrocarbons that cause the lung disease and cancer and disability and arthritis. With the alcohol, it isn't the alcohol and the high you get from alcohol that's bad. It's the liver disease you get from it, or the liver problems you get from it. With the fentanyl, people aren't dying of the high, they're dying of the respiratory depression. And so when you think about how do we stop this? Well, I became a chair of anesthesia when I was 38, and I worried because this was the most major problem. And 17% of anesthesiologists get addicted to narcotics. And you say, why? Because it's there, right? They had the candy store, and everyone would experiment. If that guy's feeling so good with narcotic, maybe I should take a trip. In one shot, 17% of us we had a little higher genetic predisposition. So I worried about what could be done about it. Well, the real solution would be to find something else that gave you a high that didn't have any side effects. We don't have that yet. But though that's where the research is going. The high is not the bad. It's the side effects of the thing that are bad. And if the side effects, if you could get something really inexpensive so people didn't have to rob stuff to get the money, gave it away free, everyone could have a high in America, right? Or at least 17% of the people would have a good high and no side effects. But when you thought about what did we do, so we had to do something that was so scary to people. And so it turned out what it was we did interventions on each other. So for the first 3 days of anesthesia residency, they did no anesthesia. They went into an intensive course where they learned about the side effects. And then to get it real, they tried to do interventions on one another. If you do an intervention one-on-one, you lose. The person who's the addict wins every time. You really learn. And it's sitting on a stage in front of your peers is really tough. But we had the entire department. We shut down a hospital for 3 days from surgical work to be able to do this. That's how important it was regarded. And that's how difficult it is. A little education, a film doesn't do it. Remember, one drink, one puff, or one shot, and you're addicted. You hear people overdosing on carfentanil. Fentanyl was a very tough to synthesize molecule. Johnson & Johnson, when they bought the company that made it, paid something like $75 million, basically, to learn how to synthesize that one compound, which was just used in anesthesia. Now, carfentanil was used for elephants. You would shoot a dart at them, and then you'd have to come and help them breathe. But if you, in a human, when we tried to use carfentanil, if you miss the dose by a millimeter on a syringe, the smallest mark, the person would need respiration or they die. And so it's that you say, why are people dying now? It's because the dosing is so really tough from what is being synthesized. So the message is, if you're thinking about it, don't even try it once, because it is way too dangerous. And that's especially true if you've got someone in your family who's been addicted to alcohol or cigarettes or narcotics. The cross-reactivity you have is probably there. Don't try it once. But the message for the Cleveland Clinic when we went back and looked at things was, tobacco isn't just the major cost, but if you look at the four things, food choices and portion size, physical inactivity, and unmanaged stress, they account for 84% of all medical costs. So we said it's pretty easy from our standpoint if we can just motivate people to manage stress, do activity, choose the right foods. It isn't rocket science, right? There isn't a person in this room that doesn't know that tobacco is bad. There isn't a person in this room that doesn't know that walking is good. But it's getting people. So we said, let's just pay people to do it. And so that's actually a model that is really doable. And we pay people more each year until we got it done. So if you look at what we call six normals, normal blood pressure, normal LDL cholesterol, normal, we couldn't get focused on outcomes, so we went to six outcomes. Said you had to have six outcomes, and if you did it, we would pay you. And we kept raising the money so that an individual gets now around $680 if they get the six normals, and a husband-wife gets a little over $1,400. And we've gone from 6% of people doing it, which was above the national average in 2009, to now 62.6% do it. And let me show you what it represents and why we got in the problem. So in the United States, calories consumed increased 2% compounded annually from 83 to 2000. And then we've stabilized. So we are now eating as a country roughly 250 calories per person more than we need to maintain our weights. And the amazing thing is physical activity decreased from 17% of people saying they did none to now 50% of people say they do none. What do we mean by none? It means that you say you don't walk 10 minutes a day, any day of the week. Can you imagine 50% of Americans now don't walk or say they don't walk 10 minutes any one day of the week with regularity. It doesn't matter whether you're a woman or a man. The blue is 1990, where it was 17%. The black is 2009 to 10. 80,000 people were subjected to this questionnaire. Doesn't matter whether you're a woman, doesn't matter whether you're Hispanic, Caucasian, Asian, doesn't matter whether you're working or not, doesn't matter whether you're a guy, etc. 50% of Americans do less than 10 minutes of walking any day of the week. The net result, our healthcare costs on a relative basis went up 50% from roughly 12% to roughly 18% as a percent of GDP. That means, and just to give it to you in a short way, instead of spending $5,000 per person and you spending $1,500 out of pocket and the corporation spending $3,500, it's now $16,000, you spending $5,000 and the corporation spending $10,000 or $11,000. That's a big difference. And that's the major cause of income inequality. 107% of the difference in income changes from 1994 to now are due to medical cost changes that you have to pay and that the corporation has to pay for your insurance. So, and by the way, the body mass index is increasing 1.25 pounds per person in the United States and has from 1990 to 2016 when we last had the data. So the average 73-year-old now weighs, compared to what they weighed 20 years ago, 26 pounds more. So normality is screwed. When people are kids, a kid who is a normal weight in 1990 is considered scrawny now. That's how much we've messed up our system. Well, the Cleveland Clinic, if you look at what was our prediction on costs, we were paying $305 per employee per month in medical costs, and the projected would be that last year we would have spent $631 or an additional roughly $400 million from what we would have had to spend for care for our own employees and dependents. That was undoable. We couldn't have given pay raises, we couldn't have had new buildings, we couldn't have new programs, we couldn't invest in a new technology that helps people. So Toby said, we can't do this. We've got to change that curve and be an experiment to see if we can. This is, as I said, the country, this is every non-government insured person in America. This is their average. It's the Kaiser Foundation data for 120 million people. From 1999 to 2015, your out-of-pocket costs on average went from $1,500 to $5,000, and the company went from paying $4,000 to $12,500. It continued to go up, by the way, this year, but at the same rate. And that's exactly pretty close to what we predicted would have happened for us. But what really happens is if you do five behaviors. If you do those five behaviors, you manage your blood pressure, your LDL cholesterol, et cetera, you have only 10% of the chance of developing a chronic disease of everyone else. In the Nurses' Health Study, the nurses who were 44 to 64 who did those five behaviors had 87% reduction in chronic disease over a 28-year period. In the, unfortunately, by the way, only 4% of the nurses who should know the best of all people did those five behaviors. And guys, we're worse. If you look at in the Swedish men's study, large study, over the 18 years, only 1% did the five behaviors. By the way, if they did them, it also was an 83% reduction in chronic disease. Most people don't know, by the way, if they get breast cancer, if they just switch oil from the usual oil used in America to extra virgin olive oil, they reduce their risk of a recurrence of breast cancer by 62%. It's pretty amazing, simply doing that. Or if they do two more fruits and vegetables and walk 30 minutes a day, they have a 90% reduction in the risk of recurrence over a 9-year period. Lifestyle choices that you make have profound effects on cancer, on heart disease, on mental dysfunction, on everything we can imagine because you change which of your genes are on or not. And I'll come back to that. Because all genes do is make proteins. They're little protein factories. And whether your genes and which of your genes are on or not, you get to control. This is called a heat map. So this is 52 guys with prostate cancer, and I know I showed this last time when I was here, but it is, to me, so powerful. I could do it with 480 women with breast cancer. We could do it with another group that has lung cancer. It's the same thing. It's called a heat map because the genes that are located in red, these are 52 guys, a strip of genes from every one of them, and 1 year later, same guys, same strips of genes, and it's a heat map because the red genes are on, they're producing proteins. And you give them sugar, and it's light up, and the sugar lights up red in this map. And so the genes that are on have to use a lot of sugar to produce the proteins. Energy source. And what's happening? These that were on got turned off. These five here are the RAS family of genes that promote the growth of breast, colon, and prostate cancer. So these genes were on and they turned them off. And here they were off and turned them on. What are these two? Those produce the GSTM1 protein that causes breast, colon, and prostate cancer cells to commit suicide. And what did they do? Well, the three guys that smoked quit smoking. Everybody meditated 15 minutes morning and night. They eliminated 5 foods from their diet, and they walked 10,000 steps a day. Not very hard, right? And everyone here knows that. You eliminate 5 foods. I'll go over the 5 foods later. You walk 10,000 steps a day. Some people accuse me of saying yes to giving talks because I walk back and forth. And you meditate 15 minutes morning and night. In fact, the dose of meditation is now 5 minutes morning and night. That's all you need to do. So the guess is, by the way, in the United States in the Nihane study, if you even take 4 of the basic things and you say only 4 of the 10 criteria for a healthy diet, only 2.7% of us do it. That's why our healthcare costs are so great. That's the message. And if you can motivate people to do those behaviors, you don't have a healthcare crisis in America. You don't have a budget deficit in the federal government. You get no income inequality. You get, in fact, the lower groups getting more income. It's simple. But we haven't motivated people to do it. Only 2.7% of Americans do it. When entering Medicare at age 65, it's 0.6% of Americans. Less than 1% of Americans do even 4 of those behaviors. Could we pay them? Yeah. Medicare costs us $13,000 per year per person, on average. If you do 5 normals, not even all 6, it costs $3,000. We could pay everyone $2,000 and still save the federal government over $6,000 per person. And we increase everyone's income. So the question is, how do we get more people? Well, although I've told you how we did it, we're paying people. And we've done this with 9 other corporations, so it's spreadable and it's doable. And we've done it with everything from white collar to blue collar to graveyards, etc. It works easily. People respond to being paid by getting healthy. Our body mass index has gone down, as you heard, 1.5 pounds or 0.5% per year for the last 4 years. This is the curve we were on, that red curve. This is the curve that our CFO will admit we're on, the green curve, but in fact we've fallen off of it and gone down more. This is our actual cost structure. You see we went up to 397, 392, 388. This year we're 382. And that's despite pharmaceutical costs going up 18% a year. It's despite our paying ourselves 3.8% more per year for hospital beds, etc. And it's very doable. We are saving $156 million compared to Mayo Clinic. This is actually the trend line. Initially, you spend a little more, and then you end up saving it, and it saves. This is the last 3 years we've saved $235 million. This year, we will save, it looks like, over $156 million. Half of which we give back to our employees as discounts and incentive payments, half of which ends up with everybody else as we decrease our healthcare costs. Our utilization has gone down 11%. We're spending 31.2% more. If you look at it compared to the Mayo Clinic benchmark, which is the 90th percentile, we're saving 32%. Or if Mayo Clinic is spending $1 in medical care, we at the Cleveland Clinic are spending 68 cents. Same quality of care. It is doable by paying people to be healthy. And by the way, our employees have taken less sick time. So if you look at the sick time, we've gone from an average of 1.07% unexpected PTO or time off to 0.77. Or if you just replaced our nurses, didn't replace our positions, said they're useless during the period of time. Sorry, Gary, David. Didn't replace the administrative staff, et cetera. It's $7 million we save per year, which more than pays for the wellness program. The 6+2 normals, in fact, if you took the savings you would have to do, we pay you to be normal. If you took that and put it into, and forget the co-pays, forget the drug costs, et cetera, but put it for a family of four into a health savings account with a 4% return per year and start at age 25, by age 60, you'd have $180,000 extra in retirement. So not only would you have better health, but you'd have more money to spend in retirement. And if you will, from a standpoint of aging, our employees, on average, the way we look at health is by aging, the employees have gotten 5.3 years younger over the last 8 years. Is it unique to the Cleveland Clinic? No, we've exported it to 9 other corporations. I'll show you the data from one of them. Is it difficult? No. Everyone says, I can't do that. I'm not going to get normal weight. So we say, just start trying. We'll give you half of the bonus for just trying. And what happens? They're able to succeed. 55% of our employees, remember I told you 62% are in the program, 62.6%, 55% are normal on all the criteria, as opposed to, at that age, the national average is 2.1%. It's amazing. It's easy. Body mass index, I told you, immunization rates have gone up. So Lafarge is a gravel company, a composite board company. They're a real manufacturing. And you'd say, we couldn't do it. And the six presidents of Lafarge came together, they had different divisions, and they said, we'll do videos with you. And I said, I don't want you guys doing videos. I want the union guy doing a video, because the union guys are the least healthy, right? So I want the union shop steward with me. And I want two production guys. And they did it. And they lost over 100 pounds each in a 6-month period. Nothing tough. They just started walking and changed their food. And yet two of them quit smoking and smoked. And it was easy. And so we now do it with 26 different Lafarge plants all across the country, 8 in Canada, 4 in France, and it's doable. And where is their cost? And the reason was this guy. Why? He was a truck driver for Lafarge on their cement trucks, and you see this? But you see these rungs on that thing? That's why they did it. He was stepping on those rungs and breaking them. They weren't strong enough for him and getting disabled. And they had to hire a high school kid in each area where they delivered cement to climb the rungs just to aim the chute. And so what happened? In 1 year, 42.8% of these guys who had metabolic syndrome got rid of it. Before that, people would say, you never can get rid of it. No, it's easy to get rid of it. You just start with walking. The difficulty is, I can't give you a pill to get rid of it. You've got to do it. So Lafarge did the same thing. They paid their employees to get well. And yeah, we know the trick. It's $800. And they got well. And of their pre-65 retirees, 50% of them got rid of it. And 17% of them, a third of them, came back to work. That saved Lafarge a ton of money, and each employee was healthier, happier, and in fact, richer. And so, and this is their cost. So Aetna estimated, based on the age and disease, chronic disease, that they would spend last year $79.5 million. They spent $42 million. It ain't rocket science. It's doable. It's doable for everyone in this audience, too. If you walked into this room, you can do it. If you rode and drove your own scooter into this room, you can do it. My favorite patient, I tell, is one of the women on the Oz show who was in a wheelchair. And I asked her, could she wear a pedometer? She said she didn't walk. And I said, you walk to get from the wheelchair to the bathroom. She walked 64 steps the first day. That's what she did. Well, and 3 years later, she was walking 10,000 steps, went from wheelchair to walker to nothing. It is doable. And this is what you could do if you did it for the federal government and you got the same participation rate, 62% for Medicare, Medicaid, vets, and federal government employees, you would stop this. And that changes everything in society. That means we can spend what we need for defense. That means we can have social programs we care about. That means we don't change the tax rate. It means, in fact, we don't have income inequality going the wrong direction. We have it going in the right direction. It is totally doable. Okay, so that's the first third of the talk, which is basically, this is doable for society. Now I'm going to tell you how you can slow your aging. And we're going to start with the largest cause of aging was stress. You'll notice that we had an increase in costs the first year. We didn't bring stress management in first. Toby said, I'm a cardiac surgeon, I cause stress. No one's quoting this, right? He said, if the nurse has to care for four patients in an ICU instead of one, I will cause it, but she's got to do that. And I don't want her belly aching to me. It was the wrong attitude. He was a retiring, if you will, a recovering cardiac surgeon. That's the attitude of most cardiac surgeons, just fuck up and do it. But in fact, and that's not bad for you, but in fact, it's horrible for our caregivers. So we brought stress management to the caregivers first, and then costs go down. Here's the data and what I'm going to show you about. This is where we are. We're a 1970 car that's worn out and looks like it's barely going to make it. Calendar age 77, real age 77, maybe 3 more years of life expectancy. But this is that same year's car, well maintained. With proper repair and maintenance, you can be about 24 years younger than your calendar age and have a lot more life expectancy. I'm going to show you that this is just the start by the end, but this is where we are. Right now, there isn't a person who can't get 24 years younger than their calendar age physiologically. That means everyone in this room could live to be about 100 with living at about 25 years younger than your calendar age. But stress is the greatest age, so it's the first thing you have to do. And we have much more stress now than we ever did. This is Carnegie Mellon's data. Sheldon Cohen developed it with 100,000 people in 1979-83. The average was 12.1 for men, 13.7 for women. Now in the United States, this is a randomized controlled trial, but it doesn't matter which group I show you. We've done it in about 30,000 people. The average in America is over 5 standard deviations where it was. We're now over 19 in stress. We're higher is more stress. And that causes your brain to shrink. If you will, what happens when you get stressed is you prune the connections in your brain. You lose memory, you lose mental function. And that's why we're losing mental function and we're all more concerned about it because we got such high levels of stress. And in fact, this is another medical center, not the Cleveland Clinic, not any place near Ohio. And you'll see 75% of the nurses had levels above 19. That associated in the Carnegie Mellon studies, I know it's Pittsburgh and I can't stand that damn Pittsburgh team keeps beating us, football. We needed the coach and instead he came here. We still need him if you follow the Browns. I told them that we have season tickets, but my wife will only go if it's going to be over 50 degrees at the end of the game or we have a winning record. We've only gone to 12 games in the last 5 years, I think. But anyway, the point is, this data from Pittsburgh showed we have now 75% of the people would have developed a chronic disease, if you look at the Carnegie Mellon data from 79 to 83, 5 years later, much higher level. But they went through a stress management program, 6 hours, an hour a week for 6 weeks, 40 minutes was on their own time, 20 minutes in a group session, and what happened? 16 weeks later, a 44% decrease in perceived stress, and only 21%, not 75%, had those levels of stress that would cause them major problems. If you look at it the other way, burnout is the reverse, and we have a lot of burnout. Nurses have less stress than average, but they have more burnout than average. So 44% of them were at high burnout level by the Maslow burnout inventory. After they took the stress management program, it was down to 14%. All of this in 6 hours. It is very doable. And what happened to cost of this medical center? They randomly allocated, they're as big as the Cleveland Clinic, and they randomly allocated 21 of their hospitals, 10 with stress management, 11 without. The 10 with, their employee costs went down 17% in the first year. This is very doable. It ain't, and we've now repeated it with 3 other organizations. So, why has healthcare needs to be fixed? Well, I told you, without it, we're really in trouble in income inequality. Let's now go to 9 steps. So the first is managing stress. We've gone over that. The second is there are 4 components of physical activity that have been shown to make a difference. But 50% of the total benefit you get from just walking 10,000 steps a day. So I'm focusing on the brain, the easy way, doing 3 months, 30 minutes a day, 3 times a week. That's all it took. And you'll notice this hippocampal area, which is the key area for memory, gets bigger. This is a lateral x-ray of the brain. This is a frontal. That's the hippocampus where memory is processed. It got 23% bigger in just 3 months of 30 minutes walking 3 times a week. Not very tough. The second component is resistance exercise. And I put these in the right order. If you do, and women tend to go, I'm walking, and guys are even worse, I'm walking, I'm going to go faster on the treadmill or faster on the elliptical. Don't do cardio second, do resistance second, so you don't injure yourself as much. So 30 minutes a week of resistance exercise, and then go to cardio. And the maximum health benefit is with 21 minutes 3 times a week at 80% of your age-adjusted max. You may get fitter by doing more, but it isn't healthier. You're just as healthy with 21 minutes. Now, I used to play a lot of a game called squash, and we would run up stairs and up hills to get in shape. And so someone said to me, do you still do that? And I said, yes. And they said, well, don't you get exhausted? I said, yeah, but I used to get exhausted when I was 19, too. It was no different. You just get exhausted, you just bucked up and did it, right? Isn't that right with the players? I mean, you're going to get tired no matter how old you are. And the difference is our attitude was different. So do the cardio. And then the amazing thing is your body says, if you're going to hurt me, I'm going to get stronger. So just jumping, you'd say, that's got to be bad for my spine and my hips. But in fact, in now 2 studies, it's the best thing. It's the only thing we know that causes increased hip size and increased spinal disc size. You would say, if I'm jumping, I'm going to shrink those discs in my spine, right? And the spine says, hell with you, you're not going to shrink me, I'm going to get bigger and stronger. We don't know if the sponge is saying that. But in any case, that's the equivalent of what happens in these 2 studies. So check with your physician before you do any of the stuff I'm talking to today, but that is what apparently happens. Obviously, you don't have to check with your physician for walking. this is what you want your spine to be. This is the spine with a fracture in it. You want it to be thicker. That's what bone looks like. It's like the Eiffel Tower, and you really want, it's not a solid structure like an I-beam. It's a lattice structure, and you notice how much thicker these lattice areas are in this person than in this one. That's why people get fractures. And that's why you get thin, and the way to stop this is jumping. Thank you. Okay, next thing is do speed of processing gains. This is actually an amazing thing. Randomized study in roughly 2,500 people. So right behind this start sign, either this car or this car, this truck or this car appears, and then someplace in the periphery, this Route 66 sign appears. You can make all kinds of, you don't have to have these things, but it is, you identify two things, one in the middle and one in the periphery, and what have that, and they give you less time. So this is computer programmed, so this is shown for 500 milliseconds, but if you get it right, you get less time. If you get it wrong, they give you more time, and it's programmed so you miss 20%. So it's programmed to always make you miss it. Now, some people would consider it fun, some of us work, doesn't matter. 2 hours a week for 5 weeks, just 2 hours a week for 5 weeks, and then 2 hours a week for 2 weeks in month 11, and 2 hours a week for 2 weeks in month 35. Total of 18 hours, and it decreased dementia rates by 48%. Randomized study of doing crossword puzzle games versus reasoning training versus this, and after 10 years, the rate in the controls were on average by then 83 years was 14%, exactly the national average. The rate in the group that did the 18 hours, 8.2%, 48% reduction. And by the way, it was also a 48% reduction in injury auto accidents. You can see that, if any of you do this, I do it now, but the first week I started doing it, I couldn't believe it, I started seeing cars where I wasn't seeing cars before while I was driving. So you really up your periphery much better. It turns out the Air Force uses this in training pilots routinely to be able to spot for planes in the periphery. So that's where I said we were. That's where you can be now. But you're learning, pretty soon we're getting to this. And what is this? The difference is the 1970 cars at best lasted 70,000 miles with proper repair and maintenance, now 200,000 miles. We're about to get a longevity revolution where you will be able to live half as old as you are. That's exactly what we're going for. So, speed of processing gains, the fourth is pretty easy. Eat salmon or ocean trout or 900 milligrams. Of DHA. DHA is the fat that coats your nerves and helps keep your nerves intact. Avoid the snake oil food. So red meat, any food with phosphatidylcholine, red meat, cheese, egg yolks. It's not the cholesterol, it's not the lipid effect. It is that they have phosphatidylcholine, which changes the bacteria inside you, which produces their waste product, trimethylamine. Trimethylamine goes to trimethylamine oxide, which causes inflammation, causes heart attacks, strokes, memory loss, kidney failure. Let me show it to you. I did a special video. I have no idea whether that'll show up tonight since we changed computers. Let's see if it does. First time. But basically the message is that what happens is carnitine, lecithin, and choline in more than 4 ounces of red meat, or more than 2 yolks a week, or more than 200 grams of pork a week, changes the bacteria in you to produce something that causes inflammation and causes heart disease, stroke, inability to fight cancer. So what are the snake oil foods? They are simple sugar, simple carbohydrates, added syrups, foods with saturated fat in them, not because of the fat, but because of the protein that comes along with the fat. We knew it wasn't the fat because it didn't cause cholesterol elevations to the same degree, but we did know it was something else in red meat and pork and cheese and egg yolks. Give sleep respect, avoid toxins like tobacco, drink coffee. The more cups you have, the lower your risk. And number 9 is take 8 supplements. I'm going to skip over some of these from a time point of view other than to show you some of the data. Half multivitamin twice a day. If you read the headlines in 2013, it said a multivitamin is useless. And it was based on data then. But I'm going to skip the congenital things. This is the health professional study. So no change in cardiovascular risk at 10 years. That is, people who took this 10 years compared to a control group, no difference. But a 18% reduction in non-prostate cancers in men over 70. So over a 20-year period, taking it from 50 to 70, resulted in a 18% reduction in cancers. We don't have anything else that does that. This is all cancers. And a 27% reduction in total cancer recurrence rate. Pretty impressive. Now, let's look at the data in 20 years of cardiovascular disease. After 10 years, no benefit. But after 20 years, a 43% reduction in heart attacks or strokes. Did you see the headlines on how beneficial it was? No. The headlines in the paper were all negative in 2013 when the 10-year data finally got reported. When the 20-year data got reported last year, same group of authors, by the way, just different first name, it was a 43% reduction, a 55% reduction in the need for heart attack revascularization. That's from a damn multivitamin, half a multivitamin. It costs about 10 cents a day if you get a Walmart multivitamin or a Costco or a Walgreens, and they're all the same. Men's over 50, multivitamin. Split it in half, take half in the morning, half in the evening. I didn't show ones for young women. Every young woman should be on it. Decreases autism risks by 40%, decreases all congenital defects by 83%, decreases childhood cancers to age 6 by 65% if you take it before 3 months before pregnancy. Sorry, your question?
Why
not? Because you pee out the water-soluble components in 12 to 16 hours. You know you do that because your urine changes color, right? Those are the water-soluble components coming out in your urine. So you need half in the morning, half in the evening to get a constant. And as I said, the 27% reduction in all death rate. So again, pretty powerful even though they don't tell you about it very much. I'll do one more. Aspirin, 2 babies with half a glass of warm water before and afterwards. We used to think it was one baby does decrease the risk of recurrent heart attacks and strokes, but it doesn't decrease inflammation you need. So one baby on clotting will last about 36 hours. You only need one every day, but for decreasing cancer risk and decreasing inflammation, you need half in the morning, half in the evening, just like your aspirin, just like your multivitamin, because the effect is only about 16 hours. So here is the cancer rates on colon cancer, started at age 65. This is the percent developing a polyp, a precancerous polyp. And you see that within 3 years, you're reducing the risk by about 40%. So 2 baby aspirins, a 10 to 45% reduction in heart attacks. It's very variable, 10% in women, 45% in men, 30% reduction in strokes. 40% reduction in major cancers like colon, breast, and none other, in prostate. Guess what? How much does 10,000 baby aspirins cost? You can buy 10,000 maybe aspirins, uncoated, which is the way you want them, at Walmart for $10. That's 6 years of protection of the strongest. There is no pharmaceutical agent we know that does anything like this. Walking doesn't even do this good. And it's much more expensive because you've got to keep buying new shoes. This is the least expensive, best way you can get younger. And obviously, if you take aspirin with a bottle of bourbon, you reduce your awareness of heart attack. I can't believe they paid for that study. Anyway, I'm going to now give you a 10th thing, which is really weird, but the data are so good I couldn't resist it. So infrared sauna is a low temperature sauna. It's a sauna with, instead of radiant heat is what the classic sauna has. You get it up to 160 degrees, you barely can tolerate it, you're sweating profusely. The room is all watery, et cetera. Infrared sauna, they have now started this in Norway, but it's gone worldwide, and the data are really impressive. If you have it 20 minutes, four times a week, one is you don't need a room with a shower afterwards, et cetera, because it's internal heat, and no one knows why it does this. But it, non-sweating in an infrared sauna, much cooler than radiant heat, for 20 minutes, four times a week, decreased the chance of sudden death by more than 50%. They say the worst thing you could have with a sauna, you think, wow, it's going to raise my heart rate, it's going to make me sweat, I'm going to have a sudden death. It decreased it by 50%. Large study, 18,000 men. And it reduced the risk of dementia and stroke by more than 60%. It doesn't make any sense, right? Well, we've got only two studies on it, so everything else I've shown you has at least four studies. This one has only two. We have no idea why this works, but I'm going and buying an infrared sauna. So you want to get a two-person version for your home. Believe it or not, they're $1,200. They're about the same cost as an elliptical, and you will have a younger heart. Now, that's the start of this talk on, we are disrupting, we are learning that longevity will disrupt us. So you're going to make yourself a lot younger. And the holy grail of aging is what we call repair. So if you had a bad hip and you could repair it by just taking something in your drinking water, would you do it? Absolutely, right? Some of the data. If you have a, if you will, I'm going to use the example of sunburn. So, have you ever had a sunburn? Did you scar with it? You did. Well, you really had a bad sunburn then. I need someone who had a sunburn and didn't scar with it. Did you? You had a sunburn and didn't scar. The key is two things. One is you had enough pluripotent stem cells and enough blood flow so that when you scar, the blood flow on skin comes from underneath, only in third degree burns where you knock out the blood vessels, or if you're older, do you scar from it? The reason being is if you have blood flow and pluripotent stem cells, you use those, they rush in and repair your skin and you don't have a scar. If you don't have pluripotent stem cells, or your blood vessels are destroyed, in the case of skin, it's a third degree burn, which destroys the blood vessels underneath, then you'll have a scar. But we waste that pluripotent stem cells. We only get so many pluripotent stem cells in life. They only get so many duplications, roughly 110. After 110 of those stem cells, they die. Then we get frail and can't repair anything. Why do you rush? And by the same thing with heartburn. You don't end up with a esophageal stricture every time you have heartburn because you have blood flow and you repair it with your stem cells. And that's the same with a heart attack. Why do you get to a hospital fast with a heart attack or stroke? It's because they will restore the blood flow for you, and your own stem cells will come in. And if you've got enough stem cells left, and you restore the blood flow fast enough, it's not you're saving the cells that are there. You're rushing in with new cells that repair it. And what happens when you have a heart attack and you get your blood flow, you'll squeeze blood out just normally, and you'll have what we call normal ejection fraction. If you don't, you'll develop what we call ischemic myopathy, and you'll have less and less blood flow excreted or pushed out to the rest of your body when after a heart attack. So that's why you want to get to the hospital fast, and also why you want to have stem cells left. Well, we only get so many stem cells. At least we only thought we did. But now, this video isn't your show either, right? Extended life expectancy about 50%. So this is what happens in animals. Instead of dying at 36 months or 37 months, they live to 50 months or 48 months. But none of us can do calorie restriction. We can't even keep the same weight in America. Very tough to go to 70%. But that's what happens by accident for 5 days a month. So imagine, can you go to 70% of your normal calories 5 days a month and then eat normally after that? And so we've done this, Walter Longo did it with 200 people at USC. We've done it with around 30 people at the Cleveland Clinic. It's very doable. People are willing to do 5 days of reduced calories and then normal eating. And what happens is you start to reproduce your stem cells. They say, hey, I can make more of myself, and it's happening. Now, we don't have long-term data on this in humans. We do have short-term data, 5 days a month, every month, of calorie restriction down to around 750 calories from 1,250, which is normal for these people, for 5 days, and then eat normally, and they reproduce stem cells. So that's what they did, and they normalized every other thing. And as I said, on June 16th of this year, the FDA approved its first study. This was with metformin, an already approved drug, $4 a month on Medicare. And what happens? This is the diabetics who are on metformin. These are normal people. This is the diabetics on a sulfonylurea. This is how long they live, cumulative survival, over a five-year period. You see the metformin, in at least with diabetics, was even got longer survival than people without diabetes, or than with the diabetics with other drugs. So the message is they're now testing metformin for its ability to slow aging, and we don't have serious side effects from metformin. So that's why this is the first drug. There's another drug as well, NAD plus. NAD is just nicotine adenine dinucleotide. It is a drug that has had a weird past because it's a vitamin, and it's really cheap. I could give one to everyone at Youngstown State at $4 a month for the right dose, and I'd be making $2 a month on each of you. That's how cheap it is. It's about $2 a month to give you the right dose. And what happens? Well, there are two things. One is it gives you a high and has no other side effect. Remember I said we're looking for a drug that gives you a high with no side effect? It seems to block narcotics in a whole bunch of anecdotal studies. So we're trying to figure out how to study that. But in addition to giving people a high, it actually slows aging in animal models. So it decreases inflammation, it maybe rejuvenate you in animal studies and in people with Duchenne muscular dystrophy, it let them have a 10-year younger real age just with the dose of this. It's a continuous dose, meaning you take it every day. The human studies show that it doesn't have a side effect that we know of. It gives you some itching, et cetera. And if you looked at the last aging, two aging conferences ago, I was asked how many people in the aging research community who know this data well. 260 people, 220 raised their hand and said they were taking it. So this is crazy, because there's not one human study on its efficacy for this purpose. But this is one of the drugs that the FDA, it's a supplement, so and it's a vitamin, anyone can get it. But in addition, the FDA, they're charging a lot more money for it now than $4 a month, by the way. But in any case, it is now the second drug in line to be studied for its effect on aging. So we are now in the exponential age. If you take of aging research, if you take linear steps and you take 30 of them, you get 30 yards across. You take exponential steps, first one is 1, second one is 2, third one is 4, remember it's exponential. If you do 30 of those, you get 26 times around here. We are in that area of aging research, where just like chips were and are, it is going to change everything. This is one of the studies in mice that came out in December. These mice had these genes turned on by changing 4 things, giving them 4 substances in their drinking water. And what happened? They repaired all the DNA damage they had accumulated over their life. And this old mice got to be a young mouse. And this mouse with old pancreas and muscle got a young pancreas and muscle from things in their drinking water. Imagine that in the year 37 again. Because that's what this does. The DNA repair gives you more energy. So instead of feeling older, you would feel 37 again. I'd be careful, sir. In any case, the point of this is we, now, the problem is if you gave too much of these cells turn into cancer cells and just multiply. So it's a careful dose. This isn't ready for prime time, but we are learning how to get things. These genes are known to repair the mitochondria. We're learning how to be able to do that. So life expectancy, if you look at 1900, we were 47, and we gained about 1 year, if you will, I don't know what that is, 47, oh, and at age 65, the average person would live to be 66. So if you were born at birth, the average life expectancy was 47. If you were 65, you would live to 1. If you look at it, you gained about 1.5 years every 10 years since 1840. So the first data we really have. So you're gaining about 1.5 years every 10 years. In 2000, the life expectancy went up to 77. And at age 65, you would live to be about age 84. So the average was still this 1.5 year gain every 10 years. Since 2000, we've gained about 2 years for every 10 years. So instead of, if you're now 65, you actually can expect to live on average to 85. This is the curve. So life expectancy at age and years and year, and it's relatively linear. It is not going to be linear anymore. It's going to be exponential. In fact, when Franklin Roosevelt created Social Security for people over 65, the US life expectancy was 56. If we kept pace, the retirement age, and kept up with the increase in life expectancy, the retirement age would now be 90. Many of us wouldn't be collecting Social Security. That's what the data would say. But it is even more interesting than that, because if you look at it now, the conservative prediction by 2030 is that at age 65, you will live to be 88. where we're gaining 2 years every 10 years. I'm going to tell you my prediction, which is really the prediction of the aging group, is by 2030, we're going to be gaining 1.5 years for every year we live. It is really, we're in an exponential area. That changes everything. And it changes everything that you do at a college or university, because it is retraining, and retraining is going to be a continuous thing. We are not going to go to education, job, retirement. We're going to go to education, job, education, time off, education, job, different job, different job, and maybe not retire until 120 or so. We are changing, it is radically changing. The aging revolution is going to radically change this. We've entered the age of exponential gains in longevity. So that car, going to this one, won't be the standard anymore. It'll be that car going to this one. And that really is, if you will, looking at it from the standpoint of how long they last, this is going to be a 200,000-mile car. We have it now, right? You expect your automobile to last a lot longer than the one from the 1970s. And you should be able to have this information as easy to obtain on your phone, and you will be able to. I'm going to skip over this, sorry. I don't know how I got it in there twice. So there will be second and third careers, and colleges and universities will be the basis of it. You will be able to have more energy, less stress, better sex, no pain, acceptance by other people, more play, experience for more, if you will, productivity, vigor, and mental creativity. Which it is, I can't tell you, when you think about living, just imagine yourself living 50 more years with the vigor you had 30 years ago. That's what it's going to be. And yet, it will require us changing the way we think about things. That's all I had. I'd be glad to talk about addiction as well. But the real point I want to make is that we're in this incredibly fast-changing part of life, and that you all have the opportunity to outlive just about anyone you ever thought about. It's actually interesting. This is the first time I've given this talk in this way, and I don't know whether the quietness is you're all shocked or not. The very interesting thing is I went to a symposium in New York yesterday, 250 people who were talking about social determinants of aging. No one, except for one guy, was prepared for this. That guy was Norman Lear, 95 years old, and he was asked what drives him, and he said what drives him is the opportunity to do new things every day. He loves it, his curiosity, he can't wait to live to be another 30 years older. He was asked, who would, you know, in Archie Bunker, who would Archie have voted for? And he said, you'll have to see the show. We're going to redo some of it. So expect a whole bunch of new shows from Norman Lear. He's still producing shows every day, and he loves it. And that's the opportunity. We all will have the opportunity of doing new and different things and enjoying it. But I got to tell you, the fact that you're reacting this way means you're just like that group in New York of people who were involved in aging. No one's prepared for this. Go ahead. Questions? Yes, sir.
Where can I find the short summary of your talk? My first question.
Are you filming it, right? Mm-hmm. You got to get it from her. I've never given it before. So I have a book coming out, as I told you, in 2 years, the book, Be Half as Old as You Are, but it's 2 years from now.
Second question is, somewhere I read that soybean-ripe foods are not good for you. Do you have any comments on that?
The only data, we have some data on soybeans from Japan. where in a randomized study, they initially gave men with prostate cancer and women with breast cancer, large numbers, 50,000 people were partake of these studies. The group that got the soy, 50 grams a day, large amount of soy protein, lived about the same age, just a little longer than the group, and had less recurrences of cancer than the group who didn't eat the soy. We don't have any other, and it's a huge dosage, so you'd expect it. Now, that was in a pre-GMO era, and we've screwed with the soybean a little bit, but we don't expect that the change of what has happened to the soybean to have made a major difference. So I don't know that you can say, at least in that study, which looked at normal Japanese diet versus a modification of that with 50 grams of soybean protein a day, there was no difference in longevity. Those studies, there was one in women and one in men. Sorry.
Can you make a little bit more of a comment on GMO food?
No. The reason is we just don't have the data. So Dr. Oz and I think you should have it labeled so you can make the choice, but we have no data that say that it is harmful to humans. If you hold on a second, if you wash it well enough to get rid of the pesticides used with it. Now, I didn't hear the second part of the question. Yeah, so there are certain substances that are harmful to human life and harmful in high doses, but aren't part of every, if you will, GMO product. So there are products, I mean, whether it's tobacco or whether it's Roundup or whether it's some other pesticides, we know that they, of and by themselves, are harmful. But you don't need those into the product. No, it's probably the blanket recommendation if you have normal risks and are a man over 35, woman over 45. But it's not, I don't do anything and say, check with your physician. There are risks of aspirin and bleeding. There are other risks of it for those allergic to it. And there is an allergic component. But if you look at society in general, it is about as safe a thing as you can get if you don't do extreme sports. So if you're participating in skiing without a helmet, you ride a motorcycle without a helmet, you do what we call extreme sports of any kind, don't do aspirin. Yes?
I watched Dr. Oz. I'm familiar with your work. I just noticed on Dr. Oz.
Isn't he good? Watch on Monday, I am on a debate with Mark Hyman, who's also from the Cleveland Clinic, on coconut oil. Coconut oil is a leading cause of mental dysfunction in my mind. So it's on our show, it's in his books. I tell him he's way off on it, and sometimes he doesn't live with the science. But anyway, we'll see how they portray the debate. I killed Mark Hyman on coconut oil because I got the data on my side, but you'll have to judge, and I have no idea how they edited it. I may look like a total idiot on Monday, but in any case, on Monday's show, we taped it a couple weeks ago, on Monday's show, if you watch, we'll do the coconut oil debate. Extra virgin olive oil is much healthier than corn oil. Okay? Now, there's a problem with extra virgin olive oil in America. American extra virgin olive oil is really extra virgin olive oil. Spanish extra virgin olive oil, Greek extra virgin olive oil, and Turkish extra virgin olive oil is really extra virgin olive oil. But the majority zones, sold in America is Italian, which has a ton of mixed oils imported cheaply, including palm oil, from Africa. So 21 of the 22 Italian sellers, Italian bottles, Vertolini, et cetera, the common ones are all being sued by the USDA for polluting their extra virgin olive oil, not using extra virgin olive oil in the damn bottle. So you want extra virgin olive oil, and you want it cheap, buy Turkish, Greek, or Spanish, or a little more expensive American. And it's really extra virgin olive oil. But the data on extra virgin olive oil, I showed you the breast cancer data, you can look at the heart data, anything, it kills every other fat. To my knowledge, I have no investment in any company that sells, makes, owns, or does anything, even owns an extra virgin olive oil. Buy an extra virgin olive oil. You know, the interesting thing is, how many olives does it take to make 1 gallon of extra virgin olive oil? 55 barrels. It's enormously tough. I couldn't believe it. It's got to be wrong, right? But anyway, that's what the data. Google it, you'll see. But anyway, extra virgin olive oil kills canola oil and mazola oil. We don't have enough data on that. I don't have dairy products because in the study of the China study, which was done in the 70s, the Chinese population started developing cancers much more commonly. The animal data, when given casein and whey, the two proteins in it, also developed cancer much, but we have never repeated the data in humans. We don't know whether that was due to some form of toxin whip that they fed the cows in China when they first introduced them, et cetera. So I avoid it totally, but I have no data. Obviously, this is for adults. I don't know anything about kids. My wife is a pediatrician. We have a deal. We never talk medicine. One and two is I don't deal with kids under the age of 18. So I have nothing to say about this. But as adults, there's no reason to have it. There are many other alternatives, and we don't have good enough data. I can tell you, I probably told this story to this group before, because I think Mary asked me once, Mary Popino, my cousin was the antithesis of me. She started working in California with the California Milk Association, and she came up with the idea, got milk. So she had my kids got, Jeffrey got Raquel Welch, a 7-foot Raquel Welch with a mustache, and Jennifer got the 7-foot Patrick Ewing with a mustache over their beds, when they're growing up. She then got promoted and went to the Wisconsin for the National Milk Board and did that campaign nationally. She then got bought out by Edelman, and she came up with pork, the other white meat. Pork is not another white meat, it is a red meat. You can see she's my antithesis. She then got hired away by Coca-Cola as the international brand manager overall. She was the second highest woman at Coca-Cola other than the executive vice president, selling sugar water to unfortunate kids around the world. She finally retired last year. But anyway, so she sold milk, which we don't know is good or not. She sold pork, which we know is hazardous to your health. She sold sugar, which we know is hazardous to your health. I couldn't, and she had much bigger marketing budget than I did.
What are your thoughts on either a vegetarian or vegan diet?
The data, we don't have randomized studies. We have studies that show that vegetarian, and especially vegan, meaning going away from any animal product, meaning no eggs, no dairy, and doing that as consistently as possible in non-randomized studies makes people live about 3 years longer is associated with it. But it's hard to do the study. You can't say, you be vegan, you be vegetarian, you be pescatarian, people don't do that. So we don't have randomized studies. We have short-term randomized studies on switching meat eaters to vegetarianism, et cetera, would show tremendous biochemical benefit and show healthier, much healthier bacteria from a standpoint. We know that the bacteria inside your gut, the varieties of them, and showing the varieties that are associated with longevity, and showing that's what happens when you go vegan. But we don't have better data than that. Anyone can get, I'll give you a free version of it now. You can get it at, if you go to brainhq.com, it's about $96 a year. Computerized programs, speed of processing. So if you've got, you can go to brainhq.com, which is the real program they use. It costs about $96 a year. AARP has a version of it for about $10 a year, I believe, at Stay Sharp under the AARP website. You can get a free version if you want to go ubrain.science. ubrain.science. Instead of a .com, it's a .science. You can get a free version of the same game. But for the record, I would recommend you get, for variety and for keeping into it, brainhq.com is a wonderful game. Thank you all very much, and thank you for